Good morning. My name is Amy Rindskopf. I am a mom in Winchester. I'm also, a lot of the kids probably know me because I've been doing the kids' table on the other side of the tree this summer.
This morning, I'm going to be doing veggie and fruit sushi, which are great for taking in lunchboxes because they're portable and you don't have to keep them refrigerated and you don't have to keep them hot. So I'm just going to be walking through the process. Please feel free to come up. If you have questions, let me know. I'm going to start talking about the rice that goes into sushi rice. Sushi rice is a particular type of rice that's a medium-grained rice. So it's not long and skinny like the long-grained white rice or basmati rice that a lot of people in this country know. Because it's a medium-grained rice, and I have a sample of raw rice up here if you want to see what it looks like, you can substitute other medium-grained rices. So a classic one that a lot of people know is arborio rice that you would use for a risotto. It's not going to be exactly like sushi rice, but it's going to be similar enough. If you don't want to have, as I do in my house, 12 different kinds of rice, you can substitute rices. So you cook sushi rice pretty much the same way you cook any rice. And when it's still warm, you want to mix it with a rice vinegar. And I've pre-made my rice vinegar and I hid it. Whoops! And there goes the water. I knew I was going to do that. This is rice vinegar that has been heated with superfine sugar or beverage sugar and salt. And I have recipes up here if you want to take one, feel free. They also make a pre-seasoned rice vinegar that I have here that's recommended for salad dressings. You can actually use it for sushi rice. I've tasted them and it tastes almost identical to the sushi rice vinegar that I've made. Now what you want to do is you're going to combine the sushi rice vinegar with the warm sushi rice. And you're going to mix it kind of like you would mix egg whites, or you would fold egg whites into a cake. So you're not going to be chopping and you're not going to be stirring aggressively because you don't want to break the rice. Sushi rice, when it's broken, gets sticky. And I know that that seems strange because sushi rice is itself sticky, but because we're adding sugar and salt and the vinegar, we don't want it to be so sticky that we can't spread it when we make the sushi.
Oh my God, I get it.
So I'm going to be making three different kinds of sushi this morning. And all of them are easily adapted to anything that you or your family would like to eat. So just because in a sushi restaurant it's made with raw fish doesn't mean you have to do that at home. The first kind that I'm going to make is called a maki roll. And that's the traditional sushi roll that you'd see in a restaurant that has a green wrapper. The green wrapper is traditionally nori, which is seaweed that's been toasted and it's squished out flat. So it's basically the seaweed you would find at the seashore, but they've processed it because it's really chewy when you find it at the seashore. It's been toasted and it's very crispy. So it will roll up well, but if you leave it out, it will get soggy and damp and then it won't taste so good. So don't leave it out. And the packages come with special sealers and you should seal it back up when you're not using it, but it will last a long time as long as it's sealed. The second type of sushi I'm going to make is called nigiri. And in a sushi restaurant, nigiri is a little ball of rice with some fish on top. I'm not going to put fish on top. I'm going to be putting fruit on top. So it's a different way of eating it, but it's the same basic idea. And it uses the same rice that you would use for the maki. And then the third is a kind called chirashi, which is not seen all that much in the U.S., but is actually the way that most Japanese people have sushi at home. And what it is a bowl of rice, and I'm going to put it in a little thermos, and then you put what normally would be the filling in a roll or would sit on top of the nigiri, you put it in chunks on top. So you could do veggies, you can do sushi, right, sushi fish, or you can do fruit, which is what I'm going to do today. And that's all of these. The idea is that they're very portable. Japanese children have been taking them to school for lunch for probably generations, and American children can do the same thing. All right, so now that I've mixed my sushi rice, I have a bamboo roller that I'm going to use to roll up my maki roll. And you'll notice that my bamboo roller is covered in plastic wrap. This is because the sushi rice gets sticky and then it starts sticking to everything, including your bamboo roller, and then you can really only make one maki roll because everything is now stuck to everything else and none of it is coming off. So you wrap it, and you want to wrap it both ways because otherwise your roller will slide out of the covering. And I'm going to take, and these sheets are big, often cutting them in half is the best way to do with it. So I'm just going to tear these in half because they're pretty, as I said, crispy, and it's not super humid today. So I'm going to lay that down on my roller, and I'm going to take a small scoop of the sushi rice. When you're first making sushi, less is more. So it may not seem like you're using a lot of rice. You really don't want to use more than, say, a cup of rice. And you want to have your fingers wet, or everything again will start sticking to everything else. And you're going to spread it out. You want to leave the far edge from you blank, because you're going to put water on that at the end to seal the roll shut. And it won't seal shut if it's got rice between the seaweed. So I'm just going to spread this out really thin. It's almost one layer of rice grains. I mean, it's that super thin. So that is the beginning of my maki roll. Now, a classic maki roll that you would even get in a Japanese restaurant is cucumber and avocado. It's a classic vegetarian roll, and that's what I'm going to make today. Travels really well for lunch, tastes really good, has protein, has fat. And the trick to anything you put in a maki roll is that you want it to be really thin. Because the thinner it is, the easier it's going to be to roll up. So I'm just going to sliver my cucumber here. You can julienne the cucumber, you can shave the cucumber, you could use a peeler to peel off a thin piece of cucumber. Sort of depends on how much time you have and also who you're making it with. Sushi is a great thing to make with kids because it's truly hands-on, and it really doesn't matter if you're making vegetable sushi if anybody touches anything, because it's all safe. There isn't any worry about food contamination from fish. You can also, and if you're doing this and you're having it at home, you could do chicken sushi. The Japanese used fish in their sushi because they were historically trying to preserve their fish. They have been fishermen for thousands of years, and until only recently they had refrigerators. And so one of the ways that they used to preserve the extra fish that they caught was they would put the fish on salt to help dry it and preserve it, and then it was too salty to eat by itself, so they wrapped it with rice, and from that you get sushi. All right, so now I'm going to see if this avocado is ripe. I have a lot of avocados this morning because you just never know when you're going to find the right ripe avocado, but this one looks pretty good. Okay. So again, I'm going to slice my avocado really thinly because otherwise it's going to be too thick. And when you're packing something like avocado in a lunch, in order to prevent it from oxidizing and getting brown, you can put a thin layer of saran wrap on top of the sushi, in between the top of the sandwich box and whatever you're putting it in. So I'm just going to lay that down like that. And those look kind of thick, so I'm going to trim them. There we go. You don't want it quite so thick. And then what I'm going to do, once I've sliced it and it looks the way I want, and when you make, you may notice that things are slipping out the edges, and that's fine, because the edge of the roll can be a piece of sushi as well. So better to have it too far out the edge, but not too far out the front. I'm going to rinse my fingers again in my little tiny bowl. And then, and this is when practicing helps, you want to sort of roll and squeeze, and you can check it as you go and make sure. And I probably have slightly too much cucumber in here. Now, before I get to the end, what I need to do is take a little of my water, and I'm just going to rub it along the edge of the sushi roll, of the wrapper, so that it will make a little tiny roll. Whoops! It is too full. And then you squeeze it, because you want it to be nice and firm, because otherwise when you cut it, it will fall apart. It will still taste good, but it won't look as good. So there's a little tiny sushi roll. Now, I'm going to cut it, and I'm going to put it in one of my little lunch boxes that I brought with me. Should we use this one? All right, so we're going to put that there. Thank you. I think it's a cute lunch box, too. As do my children, which is nice, because then they use it. So you can, if you have a nice sharp knife, you can use just a regular cutting knife. I'm using a serrated knife because these are a little bit damp, and it helps to not totally mangle the shape of the sushi. You can cut them as big or as small as your customer wants. When you have little customers, little pieces often work better. You can make dipping sauces. In Japan, in the US we do soy sauce and we often add wasabi to it. In Japan that is frowned upon. You don't do that. It would just be straight soy sauce and separate wasabi, because they would put wasabi on the roll. If you're making it for children, if you have a child who is really adventurous and wants wasabi, go for it. If you don't, as I do, then don't. Okay. No problem. I'm going to be unplugged for a moment, but I'll still be here. All right. And, okay, I'm back. So I've made some.
Thank you.
No one else. It's like a secret. Ooh, I'm back. Okay, no more secret. So the next one I'm going to make is also a vegetable roll. And working on the theory that you should make what your customers want, I asked my children this morning what kind of sushi roll I should make. And my older son said, you should make a tomato sushi roll. And I said, never had a tomato sushi roll. Okay, I'll try. So we're going to make a tomato and marinated goat cheese roll. So it's going to have rice and it's going to have nori, but it's also going to have some tomato. So the first thing I need to do is find a tomato, all right? And I'm going to slice this tomato, and again, you want it to be thin. And this is good. You don't really want the juice of the tomato because it'll make your sushi even soggier than the soggiest of sushis. So I'm going to slice the edge of this tomato here. And with the exception of the avocados and the bananas on my table, everything on my table today came from the farmer's market. So all of these foods came from the farmers right here. Oops, wait a minute. I'll need some nori. So I'm going to put more nori down and a little bit of rice. And again, I'm going to get my fingers wet. I'm going to spread it around. And I'm going to make sure it's nice and thin. And this time I put a little less rice because I found I had slightly too much rice last time. And one of the things that I think is hardest but also best about sushi is every time is slightly different and you just have to be willing to experiment a little. And oh, I have a visitor, a small fuzzy visitor who likes the sugar. The downside of making sushi outside is that the bees want to participate. And now I have a bee in my sushi. You will not be eating this sushi, your bee. Thank you. You can go somewhere else. We'll find you a peach to go play with elsewhere. Go away, bee. Psst. We did not invite you. Okay. So I'm going to take some of my goat cheese. Uh-oh. We're going to lose everybody. That's going to be bad. So the other thing you can do is change up what you wrap your maki roll in. So I have used the traditional nori wrap because I like the way it tastes, but not everybody does. And I've got a package up here that I found at Whole Foods this morning of different sushi wrappers that are made out of soy and coloring from vegetables and fruits. So there's a paprika that's sort of an orange, and there's a turmeric that's yellow, and there's some sesame seeds on another. And it's a different way of making a wrap. They're very thin, just like the nori are. And they will also, just like the nori, get soggy if you leave them out too long. But they also have the benefit of, if your child doesn't like the seaweed taste, and the seaweed taste is not very strong in nori, but it is a little bit salty. If your child does not find that to be their favorite flavor, you might find something else that they like better. Okay. Should we roll this one up? All right. I'm going to squeeze, and then I'm going to wet the edge again. And squeeze and roll and squeeze and roll. A little bit more.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, good. That one turned out much better. Excellent. So, proving my explanation that practice makes perfect, this one's getting better. So I'm going to slice this one pretty much the same way I did with the last one. And oftentimes you will find your knife gets sticky, and so you kind of want to wash down your knife as you're doing it. The rice itself is not super sticky, but once you combine it with the sugar and the salt, it's like glue, which is good for holding your sushi together, but not so much for cutting your sushi. There we go. Okay. So other things you can use for wrappers in a maki roll, and I'm going to do one of those later when I do fruit sushi, you could use a tortilla, you could use lettuce, you can use a thinly sliced cucumber, if you make a long, thin strip of a cucumber, or melon if you want something fruitier. All right. So there we have tomato and goat cheese sushi. And this is a nice little box that we happen to use at home, but it's great for packing in lunch boxes or packing in snack bags, or you can just put it in the fridge and have it for later. Yes, ma'am, you have a question. Yes, they do sell them at Whole Foods. That's right. You can see these at Whole Foods. Stop and Shop also has different types of containers. I got this one at Stop and Shop the other day. It's got a little spot for putting a dip in. You could put a soy sauce dip. You could put some other kind of dip. If your child likes ranch dressing or something like that, that could be the dip that they're having. All of it is good. So now that I've made some veggie sushis, I'm going to make one more maki that's a fruit maki. So I'm going to use one of the orange wrappers that I've got. So I'm going to get rid of these things because I don't want my veggies and my fruit together. That would taste funny. And I'm going to use banana. Now, banana has the benefit that it's one of those fruits that once you open it, you can just eat it. And it's round. So you can either use it whole if you want, or if that's too big a slice, you can make little thin slivers of the banana. And I'm going to make thin slivers of the banana. As cute as a whole banana sushi is. Banana sushi. So bananas and all fruits have the problem that unlike the sushi rice, they're not super sticky. Bananas are pretty sticky, as all of us who are parents know when your child has left bananas in your car or your house or somewhere else that they weren't supposed to leave it. But they're not super, super sticky. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to spread something underneath. And so I asked again in my house what they wanted. And my husband said, well, obviously you need Nutella if you're going to have a banana. And I said, right. So we're going to have a Nutella banana coconut maki. But you could do, and I have some here somewhere. Oh, I have some soy nut butter, which you could also do. So, you know, whatever it is that works for your child or you and your flavors, those are all good. Yes, ma'am, you have another question. You're paying attention. Do you have this at your house? Does anyone else have this at their house? Does anyone else like this? Awesome, that's good. We have it in our house. We like it a lot. Well, some of us like it. Some of us don't like it in our house. So I'm just going to make a thin spreading of this, and this is sort of like my rice.
Yeah, that's I
first found it
in Switzerland.
Yeah. This is on a soy wrapper that's got paprika for color. So everything in here is non-GMO certified, and I just found these at Whole Foods when I was looking for my nori. And the nori you can get at Whole Foods, and you can get a lot of other grocery stores now. A lot of grocery stores now have sort of international food sections, and there's an amazing assortment of things to be found there. So I've just spread a thin layer of Nutella. Now I'm going to take my banana. My banana is a little bit fatter than I want, so I'm going to slice my banana the long way. And there might be some Nutella in my banana, but since it's going into the Nutella sandwich, I figure that's okay, right? You think that's okay? We won't tell anyone? Excellent. All right. So I'm going to take some of the banana. The paper actually doesn't have much flavor. It's just sort of like paper. But now it has flavor because we put Nutella on it. Right? So it's basically orange Nutella paper.
Yes.
Yeah. How good would that be?
I don't know, good.
I think it'd be good too. Okay. So I'm going to rinse off my fingers again. And there's a lot of dipping and rinsing and dipping and rinsing when you make sushi, which is fine. That's right, I'm sticky and I don't really need to be super sticky. So I'm now going to roll this up. And again, I'm going to use a little tiny bit of water to seal the edge. And that came out sort of skinny. Wait, I'm going to redo it with more banana. So you can also undo as I'm doing, because you realized I didn't put enough banana in. There's not enough banana here. We need more banana. So, more banana. And then what I'm going to do at the end, so if I were packing this in somebody's lunchbox, probably my husband's, not my children, banana, once you cut it, can oxidize. So you can do the trick of putting plastic wrap on the end, or, and I guess actually I wouldn't do this for my husband because he doesn't like coconut, but what I'm going to do is dip the ends in flaked coconut, and then it's sort of covered and it's cute. And again, you know, whatever works for your particular customer base, it's all good. There's no wrong way of making fruit sushi or veggie sushi at home. If it means that the person you're making for will eat their lunch, then that's a good thing. All right. So I need a knife. Uh-oh, I lost a dish. It is easy to cut. Yeah, this wrapper is easier to cut. Or maybe it's this knife. Hard to know. All right. Whoops. So I'm going to put that there. And where did I put the coconut? There's the coconut. Brought coconut today. I do too. Coconut is very tasty. Some people like coconut, and some people, they just don't. And that's okay. Alright, so we're going to put those in there. And these are a little skinnier than I think I would do. And again, this is all part of the practice. There are many bananas that get eaten in the name of making good banana sushi. All right, so the next dish that I'm going to make while I'm finishing up my banana sushi here, which looks kind of tasty, is I'm going to make chirashi. Chirashi, somebody in front wanted to know what chirashi is, and I'm going to tell you.
I want to know too.
Excellent. I'm so glad you guys are curious and want to know. Chirashi is bowl sushi. So you don't need a wrapper. What you need is a bowl, and I'm going to put it in that little thermos. And then you chop your toppings and put them on top. So I'm going to make fruit chirashi today, because that's part of our theme. But in Japan, chirashi is actually the way Japanese people eat sushi when they're at home. They don't tend to do really fancy sushi, because it's expensive and it takes time, and a sushi chef is really the best person to get fancy fish sushi from, because they learn for years and years and they make all sorts of specialized things. So here's my banana Nutella coconut sushi, and I put it right in the lunchbox, because we have all sorts of lunchboxes in our house. Okay, so for chirashi, I'm going to take a bowl, and I'm going to scoop probably, it looks like maybe just under a cup of rice. And I'm just going to put the rice in there. Not going to pack it in, because you don't want it to be too thick. And then I'm making a fruit chirashi. So I'm going to add some peaches. So I'm going to slice some peaches. They might get a little Nutella on them. Do you have peaches at your house? Do you guys like peaches? Fruit is good. You can use any kind of fruit you want for this. I picked peaches because they were at the farmer's market today, and they looked really good. If you like apples, you could use apples. If you like pears, you could use pears. If you like plums, or cherries, or raspberries, or blueberries. I do have raspberries. I have raspberries, and I have pears, and peaches, and apples, and plums. There might be. They might be getting ready for music. That's right, I have avocado, and avocado is sometimes a fruit and sometimes a vegetable. It all depends on how you eat it. Well, it is classified as a fruit because of its pit and the way it grows, but some people think of it more as a vegetable. Tomatoes are the same kind of thing. I know a farmer who says it's all about how you're eating it. If you're eating it like a fruit, then it's a fruit. And if you're eating it like a vegetable, it's a vegetable. Which is a pretty simple way to look at it, right?
I've never had it like a fruit. Never thought of it that way.
There you go. See, now you've got a whole new way to think about it. All right, now I'm going to do a plum. No, I'm going to do a pear. That's a plum. It's not a round plum. It's also called a prune plum. We use them to dry them and turn them into prunes. It does kind of look like a baby one. So I'm going to do some pear. Ooh, these pears are a little firm. Yeah, there's a little wind down here at the market today, which you can now hear on my headphone. All right. Pear. You guys know pears? I love pears too. And I think if it was my chirashi bowl, I might have a slightly riper pear, but we take what we can get at the farmer's market. Okay, so I'm going to take these. And if you wanted, depending on, again, your customer and how sweet they like things, you can make a sauce to drizzle on top. You could add honey, or you could add agave syrup. But this is what a chirashi bowl would look like. And then I had a top somewhere. There would be a top, and I would just screw it shut, and it could go just in the lunchbox like that. So the last type of sushi that I'm going to make today is called nigiri. And nigiri consists of a ball of rice and something on top.
I've had that before.
Have you had that before?
Yes.
Oftentimes, a lot of people know them with salmon. They do fish. Yep, they do raw fish and cooked fish. And what basically you do is you take a little handful of rice and some plastic wrap. And again, my rice is very sticky, so I'm going to rinse my fingers off so that I'm not super, super duper sticky. And what I'm going to do is wrap this up with my saran wrap and squeeze it and make a little tiny ball of sushi. Just like that. Squeeze. It's all about the squeezing. And you can squeeze these ahead of time and then put your topping on. You don't have to squeeze and top and squeeze and top. So I'm going to make a couple of them since I've got this perfect little piece of paper. And I'm going to put it right there in my box.
Hey, can I get some?
The They do look like a ball. Now, the other thing about sushi rice that I learned from students, I was giving a sushi demo in a school, and the kid said, can we just eat the rice? I said, absolutely, you can eat the rice. So I had extra little bowls of rice, and some of them just ate rice, which is okay, too. The sushi rice tastes good because it's a little sweet and a little salty because it has vinegar and salt and sugar. So I'm going to make a couple of these. And then I have some different kinds of fruit to put on. So I have some dried mango slices. I will show you. Do you know what a mango is? So mangoes look kind of like bigger avocados on the outside, but on the inside, they're orange. And I have a big flat pit. Yep. Do you like mangoes?
Yes.
Mangoes are tasty.
Yes, they are.
Mangoes are really good for you, too. They have lots of vitamin C.
Yep.
But you can use dried fruit as well as fresh fruit to do a nigiri. It's really just a question of, again, flavors and taste. Nigiri are more or less bite-sized, so you don't have to worry. Mango, dried mango in particular, gets kind of tough, but it doesn't really matter because it's going to be a bite-sized piece. It's going to be a little tiny piece that's going to sit on top of your little piece of rice. So they're also nice because for people who don't want to bring forks and utensils or even chopsticks, you can just pop these in your mouth. The best way to get the skin off of a mango is to not get the skin off the mango. You split the mango in half, and then you use a knife to cut down along the pit. Pits are flat in mangoes, so you can see the mango will be wider one way than it is the other. And if you trim it that way, you will end up with a half that's full of mango flesh. And then if you grit it, and then scrape it. No, you're going to cut around the pit. They make pitters that are sort of designed like that. But essentially, you're going to cut off two half globes.
Yeah.
And then you can, if you make a grid cut mark with it and then scrape that out, you can flip them out at that point and just scrape them the other way. But yeah, if you try and cut the outside, they get very slippery very quickly and you end up cutting yourself and doing all sorts of things. But yeah, that's the easiest way I've done. All right. I think we need one more. So, the other thing you can do with fruit sushi, with regular sushi, you might want to have soy sauce or maybe a salad dressing to dip them in, but fruit sushi, probably not so much. So you could do a honey sort of dip, or you could do a yogurt dip. So if a yogurt dip, you could have vanilla yogurt to dip your fruit sushi in, or you could do honey, or you could do honey yogurt. You could add honey to yogurt. Whoop! Everybody okay there? Things are flying off the table.
Yeah.
Excellent. All right. So I got one more of these. Okay, so now I've got five of those, and I'm going to take my knife, and I'm going to see how easy it is to cut this mango, and it's pretty easy. So I'm going to get a little water on the mango, because I want it to stick to the rice. And you could, again, you could use, and I didn't bring any honey with me, but you could use honey or anything else that you would use in a sandwich. So you could use soy nut butter or anything else to just help it to stick
something you think I would like.
To the rice. There we go. What else could I put? Oh, I know. I could put a raspberry on top. I'll cut this raspberry in half because I have raspberries. I do, too. Raspberries are pretty awesome. Particularly when you can get them at Right Lock Farm, and all you have to do is go home. Oh, there we go. There's one, a raspberry on top of that one. And actually, it's one raspberry I cut in half. How was that for sneaky?
Yeah.
All right, so now I'm going to do a slice of this plum so you guys can see what this plum looks like on the inside. A little plum hat. Yes, ma'am. You just like the rice? You know, sometimes I like just the rice, too. Let's see, what should I do for the other two? What do you think? I have spinach, I have basil, I have tomato. Ooh, I could do, I know, we'll do some pear.
Pear. Pear.
Yeah.
Pears, yay.
So. Pears are your favorite? They're one of my favorites, too. There we go. Ooh, look, that pear almost is hiding on top of the rice. You can barely see it. And then I have a little bit of peach left, so I think I'll put some peach on the last one. So, but as you've seen, sushi can be really flexible, and it can be a lot of fun to make and have an assistant help you. And there's nothing better than something in your lunchbox that you know is going to be tasty and you really want to eat. And that goes for big people and little people. Excellent. There we go. Thank you so much for listening. I have recipe cards up here that tell you how to make sushi rice and make the vinegar sauce for it and give you ideas on what you can add. But honestly, the sky is the limit, and whatever works for you is great. Thanks for coming. Thank you.